confused.
No way.
I can't even cut my hair.
No way.
Can't even dance my dance.
No way.
Just can't make it without you.
No way.
I just can't make it without you.
No way.
I just can't make it without you.
No way.
I just can't make it without you.
No way.
I can't even tell the time.
No way.
Can't even push rewind.
No. Yeah.
I can't even drive my car.
No way.
What's going on, everyone? We want to say happy Wednesday, happy hump day to all of you. Welcome to the fun this evening. But to formally welcome you, I want to bring at this time to your attention the one and only Executive Secretary of the Lake Region Conference, Elder Garth Gabriel, will come on and give us a warm welcome and prayer to get us going. At this time, Elder Gabriel.
Thank you, Pastor Bell. Pleasant good evening to everybody. I am so excited. That music had me excited. I was ready to tune in and get what we can tonight. We've been blessed thus far by these very spiritual sermons and just the music. We've just been blessed. So Pastor Bell, I want to commend you again. And I know that we're going to just really do great things on behalf of God, not only this week, but in the weeks to come. So again, we welcome everybody for tuning in, coming in tonight. We have been blessed since the last evening with Dr. Henry. We were blessed by Pastor White and Pastor Cannon. And tonight we're going to be blessed again by Pastor Baldwin as he brings the fourth word that Jesus spoke from the cross in his duel with death. And so I'm excited about it. Matthew 27, 46. My Lord, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? I can't wait. And so at this time, before we go any farther, let's begin with prayer and ask God's blessing on this program. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love, your grace, your mercy to us. And now, Lord, we pray that you would be with us, be with everyone who has taken the time to tune in to these messages. We pray, Lord, that you would bless each household. You know what we're facing even right now, Lord, but we are here together because of you. You are in total control of our lives. And I pray tonight that you would touch Pastor Baldwin in a special way and let him speak a word, Lord, that we may just enjoy and that we'll be blessed by it. So we thank you again for this opportunity to praise you in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Pastor Bell.
Thank you so much for that prayer and that warm welcome, Mr. Secretary. We appreciate you greatly. Well, ladies and gentlemen, as you've heard already, I just want to restate again and can't say it enough. We're so excited to have you here with us. We are excited to really keep going through these seven last words. The first 3 days have been incredible, and we are very, very, very elated about this fourth word that is coming up. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Have you ever felt that before? Have you ever wondered where is in your situation, in your circumstance? Well, tonight, let's find out what it felt like for Jesus to be on the cross and utter such a saying to his Father. This evening, as we progress through our program, I want to bring up our one and only Dr. Christina Wells, who is our health advisor here in the conference. She is on the front lines and is willing to come to us, even from the hospital at work, to give us some hopeful health nuggets. And so we want to say, first and foremost, thank you so much for every sacrifice you and other medical professionals are making on our behalf to keep us safe. And we want to pray God's rich blessing over all of you as you continue to serve in the ways that he has gifted you. So Dr. Wells will come and give us a hopeful health nugget, which will be followed by a ministry tip given to us by our preacher last night and also doubles as our youth director, Dr. Abraham Henry. And then following him, one of our young people is going to pray this evening in the form of Mr. Josh Essex. So at this time, we will go in that order. Dr. Wells, it's all you.
Thank you, Pastor Bell. I appreciate that introduction and also appreciate the prayers. When God had made the world and darkness was upon the face of the deep, he said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. The benefits of sunshine. Sunshine has many benefits. It is important for the production of vitamin D. It can help to improve blood pressure. It can help to improve mood, and it can also help to improve sleep. Sunshine and vitamin D. Vitamin D is produced when the sun contacts our skin. Vitamin D is important for many hormonal processes. Vitamin D is important in regulating calcium and phosphorus balance in the body, which is important for the health of bones and teeth. Vitamin D also helps facilitate normal immune function. And there have been some recent reports that say that vitamin D can be helpful in being protective against COVID-19. So store up and take more vitamin D in and get outside when you can to get more sunshine. Sunshine and blood pressure. When the UV light from the sun hits the skin, it actually increases the production of nitric oxide and its release into the blood. Nitric oxide is a potent vasodilator, and it's important in helping to regulate blood pressure control. Sunshine is also important for sleep. Exposure to sun and the bright light in the morning helps regulate the evening production of melatonin. Melatonin is important in helping us have appropriate sleep regulation. Sunshine and mood. Exposure to sunlight is thought to increase production of a hormone called serotonin. Serotonin is important for mood regulation and can help a person feel calm and focused. So it's important because serotonin is also what we find in antidepressants. So if you're having trouble with your mood or having problems with anxiety, instead of maybe getting an antidepressant, you might want to spend more time in the sun. Serotonin can also be important in regulating sleep. Sunshine and the S-O-N. Psalms 113:3 tells us, from the rising of the sun unto the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised. Sunshine and COVID-19. we should spend at least 10 to 30 minutes in the sun midday. Use a mask when in public. No one left behind. This is so important. We're getting recent reports that African Americans are being disproportionately affected by COVID-19. In Chicago, 72% of the deaths from COVID-19 were in African Americans. So we have to remember that everyone counts, everyone matters. If we have information, we should share it with others so that others can be educated about the benefits of our health message and also about what they can be doing to protect themselves in these times. We should continue practicing social distancing, hand washing, invest time daily in personal devotion with God, never, never, ever lose faith, and eat your fruits and vegetables. Thank you.
All right, good evening, everyone. We want to welcome you once again to our service and our program. It is a pleasure to serve you. My name is Dr. Abe, and it's a pleasure to be the youth director here at the Lake Region Conference. And I want to share with you five different things that are important for dealing with and supporting teenagers or young adults during this time of coronavirus, COVID-19. Number one, youth and young adults are used to hanging out, engaging in sports, and engaging in outside activities. This is oftentimes going to be a very problematic time for them because it may cramp their style and their regular routines. However, it is important that we don't just share with youth and young adults that it's important to engage in social distancing. Don't just tell them how, it's important to tell them why. It's important to share with them that even though they may be willing to take a risk to be around their friends, and that their friends may be look fine, it's important for them to understand that we are still gaining information as to how this virus is affecting people. Their friends may look normal at the moment that they're interacting with them, but before they notice that they are coughing and exhibiting signs, they may have already passed on the virus. Number two, it's important to share with them that even if they're willing to put themselves at risk, that when they come back home, they put everyone at risk in their homes. So it's important to share those items with them. Number two, it's important to assist in facilitating and normalizing remote learning. A lot of them have come home, and where they used to go to school, it is now in their living room. And so it's important to do the following: create a clean and comfortable environment for them to work in. Number two, encourage them to wake up early, encourage them to shower and get dressed and feel good about the day. Number three, promote breaks in between their classes. And so as they go through routines and practices and workshops, make sure they take breaks to relax and take a deep breath, because this can oftentimes be a very overwhelming time. Also, the teachers are not there and their friends not there to help encourage them and applaud them. It is our job as parents to make sure that we applaud and encourage every single thing that they do, because this is a very challenging time. The third thing I want to say is encourage healthy habits. I know that it may seem like a disruption for them to be home. They may be comfortable and matriculated to the environment because this is their house. However, it's important to make sure that they engage in getting adequate sleep each night. It is recommended that they get anywhere between 6 to 8 hours of rest. It is recommended that they eat healthy meals. This stuff affects, as our doc told us a few seconds ago, this stuff affects how they work. Also, encourage them to exercise regularly. While we don't want them to go outside and play basketball and be tossing around the frisbee or be hanging out on the block, we want to make sure that they can do certain exercises at home. Also, be mindful of how this psychologically affects them. Losing out on important events like high school sports season, proms, senior banquets, homecomings, award ceremonies, team sports, high school and college graduations, make sure that you facilitate what we call parents, we want you to act in response to this. We want you to acknowledge the real stress that they are under. We want you to provide confiding spaces, which means that they can express how they feel without being judged or their feelings being minimized. And number three, talk to them. Talk to them about your trust and their ability for them to rebound from these circumstances. Lastly, find fun and engaging ways for them to find stuff to do. So they can engage in outreach or mask making to serve their community, their neighbors, and those in their houses. find appropriate Christian games for them to engage in. And guess what? If you're having a hard time finding stuff for them to do, right here in Lake Region Conference, our youth department has been very intentional to find stuff for them to do. We have a youth and young adult church at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, right here on Lake Region Conference's website. We have a pajama praise party, which is a way to bring in the Sabbath once a month on Friday evenings. We have a young adult cafe, which is an art and soul gospel cafe for youth and young adults to share poetry and other things with each other. And we even have a Pathfinder and Adventure Honor Summit, which means they can do stuff at their home to stay entertained, to stay connected, and to stay together. We want you to know that your kids are important because everyone counts and everyone matters. At this time, as we prepare for prayer, we want to remind you that we have our website, which is www.lrcsda.com. We want you to log onto our website and share your prayer request for us, because one thing that ties us together, even though we may be apart, is that we believe prayer is the chain that keeps us together. So won't you go ahead and use that website to go ahead and put down your prayer request? And we want to remind you that in just a few seconds, as we petition the throne of grace, let's one more time get into that mindset. Let's welcome Josh Essex as he leads us in prayer.
Good evening, saints of God. I'll be doing prayer tonight. Please bow your heads and close your eyes. Dear Heavenly Father, we approach your throne of mercy tonight, asking for you to heal our land. In 2 Chronicles 7:14, we find that you say, "If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, then will I heal their land and forgive their sins." So, Lord, in this day and age where we're all at home because of COVID-19, we petition your throne. We ask you to heal our land. We ask you to help us seek your face more. We ask you to help our leaders. Lord, we can't do anything in and of ourselves. Lord, if it weren't for your mercies, we wouldn't be here today. Lord, help us as we go through this challenging time. Help us to stay connected to you, to those in our lives, such as our friends, our family, mothers, fathers, sons, daughters. Help us to remember that throughout it all, you are there looking down from heaven saying, my child, I have not forsaken you. It may seem like it sometimes, but I am here for you. I always have been, and I always will be. Lord, be with us. It's a day where we don't know if we're going to wake up tomorrow, where this virus could already be in us and we don't know. So Lord, we ask for you to protect the saints that worship you. We ask for you to draw close to those who are hurting because they've lost loved ones. Lord, most importantly, we ask you to seal those who worship you, who stand on your Bible and your truth. We ask you to seal them in your kingdom. And we pray that when that day comes, when we hear your trumpets and you coming down from the sky on the cloud with angels and all of heaven with you, we pray that we may be there and we may be saved. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Thank you so much to Josh for a powerful prayer, to Dr. Abraham Henry, Dr. Abe, for bringing us some awesome tips. Parents, we ought to act ACT. So to make sure that we are in compliance with that, to make sure that we help our young people transition through this tough time of COVID-19. And also Dr. Wells for being on the front lines and just really even being from the hospital, giving us encouragement about how we can get out, how we can stay healthy, and how we can stay safe. We praise the Lord for every last one of your ministries. Well, there's one more ministry that I want to discuss this evening, and that is the ministry of Pastor Earl Baldwin. He is a good friend. He is a brother. He is a colleague here in the Lake Region Conference. He pastors the Praise Fellowship Church in South Bend and also the Bethany Chapel Church in Elkhart, Indiana. He is the husband of one wife, Sister Janika Baldwin, and they have a tribe of Baldwins with them. They have five wonderful children, and we praise God so much for his ministry. He is a powerful preacher. He is a powerful teacher. He is a man of God, and he is driven by the Spirit of God to do wonders, not only within his church, but within his community. And so after the next selection, the thing that you will hear next will be that pronouncement of the word of God, that exegetical study, that great pulling out of the text, as we would say, by Pastor Earl Baldwin, as he preaches to us about, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? God bless you this evening.
Upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail, and there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stay. Rise, myself will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Oh, oh, yeah. Your grace abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you never failed and you won't start now. So I will call upon your name. Rise, myself will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Oh, oh, yeah. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me, and take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without. Let me walk upon the water, wherever you would call me, and take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. So I will call upon your name. Oceans rise, myself will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. I am yours, and you are mine. I am yours, and you are mine.
Good evening, Lake Region. How is everyone doing? What an amazing rendition. I want to say thank you so much to Kendra and to KJ. Again, we are so proud of what you guys are doing. It is my privilege to be with you this evening, and I pray that you guys are holding up. I know how stressful things can be right now. I want to say thank you so much to Pastor EJ Bell for the invitation to be part of this amazing panel. For those who have gone before me and blessed my heart, I want to say thank you so much. And for those to come still, I pray that God's word will continue to go out with power and with clarity. This evening, I have the privilege of speaking the fourth words of Jesus Christ. But before we go any further, I just want to take some time just to say thank you to my wife and to my kids. Right now, I'm speaking to you from the house, and it is quiet. Can you hear that? It is quiet. That's a blessing in of itself. But I want to say thank you. They've been putting up with me so much, been shushing them and telling them, quiet, I'm going to call. It's been so busy and so hectic during this time. But I know that God has a blessing in store for us. But let's say a word of prayer. So Heavenly Father, we say thank you for your love and for your mercy. We simply ask that you will speak with boldness and with clarity through me. Remove me, dear Lord, and I pray that your people will hear what they need to hear. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to speak to you on the topic or the title, Footprints. The words to this song simply says, Footprints of Jesus, leading the way. Footprints of Jesus by night and by day. Sure, if I follow, life will be sweet, saved by the prints of his wounded feet. Right now, as the world is in complete chaos, if we but listen, you can hear a question that is being asked all around the world. That question is being asked by that person who was just diagnosed with COVID-19 and they're stuck in the hospital. That question could be heard by that mother or father as they listen to their child cry out of hunger, and there's nothing they can do to help because there's no food in sight. That question could be heard as that person who was just laid off because the economy has just tanked. That question could be heard by that young child who was molested or raped or abused, or maybe that person who is questioning and wrestling with their sexuality. That question was even heard by our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, as he hung on that cross and he said, why? You see, that question, why, will continue to exist as long as the gulf of sin continues to separate humanity from divinity. You see, God never intended for us to be separated, though we would have never ever understand everything like God. We would have understood what we needed to understand, and that question of why would be removed. And this is why, as we look at scripture, you get to understand when you read Isaiah chapter 55, when the word of God declares, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways. As the heaven is higher than the earth, so are my ways from your ways. You see, there is a divide because of sin, and Jesus and the Godhead, as they looked down on this situation, and they were hurting because they were separated by the very ones that they loved. They came up with a plan, and Jesus dove into the cesspool of sin called humanity, diving into the womb of a young woman by the name of Mary. And from that moment on, he began to leave footprints in the sand of life. And he's leaving those footprints there for a reason, because everyone counts and everyone matters. You see, he needed for us to understand why this thing called sin was nothing to play with. And the divine creator is coming alongside us, trying to get us to understand why we need him and why we must stay away and push away from sin. And this is why in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18, God makes an invitation. He invites you and he invites me. He says, come now, let us reason together. He says, though your sin be as crimson, you see, God is trying to get us to understand that sin is an enemy of us, of each and every one of us. He wants us to know that he wants to wash us up and clean us. He wants us to be white as snow, to be white as wool. And that blows my mind, especially as Pastor Bill in his brief bio said, I have a tribe, and praise God, my quiver is full. Amen. But one of the things as a parent that I struggle with is being able to take the time to explain something to my child. Here it is now, God, the God of the universe is saying, come now. He's inviting us to come alongside him. Let us reason together is what he's saying. Imagine an astrophysicist or some type of chemist trying to explain to my little four-year-old son how a nuclear explosion happens. I could see little Zion shaking his head like, okay. But yet still, God is saying, I need for you to understand why sin is so hurtful. We have become so accustomed to sin, it has lost its effect. That nasty smell, we have become accustomed to that odor. We have grown accustomed to seeing people die. We are losing loved ones. And Christ is saying, come now, let us reason together, because he needs for us to understand we need him. He needs for us to follow in his footprints and place our feet where he has placed his feet. But Jesus was laying out an example, not just of the good and easy thing as a divine creator. He was very intimate with suffering. Many people are suffering right now. Many people are hurting right now. Many people are asking the question, why? What's going on? They're uncertain, even though his word declared this. Matthew 24, Luke 21 told us about things that were to come so that when it happens, we will believe him. And here it is now. I want us to follow those footprints. And I want us to follow these footprints into a garden. The scene, it's dark outside, and he says to the rest of the disciples to stay here. He just takes three of his closest disciples with him, and he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane. And as the word of God declares, the Bible says that he was heavy, his heart was heavy. And I need for us to see this. I need for us to feel this, because there's someone listening this evening. There's someone who may listen to this broadcast later, and you're going through it right now. You are like Jesus crying out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And this is our God. This is Jesus now, all powerful, the one who said, let there be light in the beginning. He is in the Garden of Gethsemane. And the Bible says he was so heavy that he fell to the ground on his face. The weight of sin, the weight of what he was dealing with was so heavy he fell on his face. But praise God, he was not there by himself, because he took three of the chosen ones to pray and to come alongside him, as he's calling the church to do right now. And as he's praying, he says, my Father, is there any other way? Can you take this cup from me? This is Jesus speaking now. This is not you. This is not me. This is the divine creator in human flesh now crying out, is there any other way? He knew he was to be the lamb slain from the foundation of the world, yet still Jesus is crying out, is there any other way? Can this cup be taken from me? Footprints in the sand, because you see, Jesus understands that we will have a Gethsemane moment before he comes again. And he wants to ensure that we will not fail the test of life. And he's there and he's crying out. And I want you to see this imagery now. He comes back to Peter, to James, and to John, and he does not find them sleeping. He does not find them singing praises or reading scripture. He finds them sound asleep. Are we sleeping during one of Earth's greatest crises? Are we sleeping when humanity is needed most? And you see, I want you to get it, because someone is wrestling right now thinking God has abandoned you. You've been praying. You've been getting up in the morning seeking clarity. And as you continue to navigate, I want you to understand that Jesus himself now is crying out to God, is there any other way? And he comes and they are sound asleep. They're sleeping when humanity needs them the most. He goes back and he's praying and he's talking with his father some more. And yet still, watch this now, as he comes back, they're still asleep. Remember the question that he asked the Father. Father, is there any other way? Can this cup be taken from me? And it is in this moment, some years ago, God revealed it to me because I felt as if he had abandoned me. I realized that he did not even abandon his son, because in that moment, it was as if God was saying to Jesus, look at the ones that you've come to save. They can't even stay up. They can't even stay up. This is why, son, there's no other way. This is why, my son. And as you see this, I can imagine Jesus walking back and forth. And I think that he's being very intentional to place his feet in the exact same spot to make a deeper impression into the ground, to make sure that when his people, his children, find themselves in the Gethsemane moment of their life, they know how to make their way through, because those impressions, those footprints in the sand, you will notice that he left that impression in the ground so that they can make it through. Let's follow those footprints out of the Garden of Gethsemane and let's fast forward all the way to the cross. Here it is. The Bible says, at the sixth hour, and I want to read it directly from the word for you. I want to read it because this thing ain't no joke. Have mercy. As we look at Matthew chapter 27, someone needs to hear this, because you know what I'm feeling. Because when you feel as if God is not even close to you, when he's not even hearing, and this is what the Bible says, starting from verse 45, it says, now from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, there was darkness over the land. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is to say, my God, why have you forsaken me? Have you been there? Maybe there's someone there right now, but I want us to pay attention to something in verse 45, because it's so easy to miss things. You know, sometimes when we're watching sports or something, you're watching the game and you see the referee make a call and you say, are you blind? How could you make such a dumb call? And they put something on the screen called instant replay. And with the instant replay, we're able to see things that we missed with the naked eye. Watch this now. The Bible says, now from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, there was darkness. The sixth hour is noon. The ninth hour is 3 p.m. It is interesting that when the sun was supposed to be at its highest, its hottest, and its brightest, there was darkness on the face of the earth. You see, the S-U-N even had to humble itself to the S-O-N, and its light was nowhere to be found. You see, darkness is simply the absence of light. And Jesus going through this, he was leaving footprints in the sand because he knew that some of us were going to feel abandoned. He knew that that person who was abused night after night, these kids are back home, maybe with their abuser right now. Maybe they're locked in a house, a husband, a wife, whoever. I don't know your situation. I just want you to know that God knew that you were going to be there. And what he is saying, follow my footprints. I understand your pain because I've been there. I understand your pain, my child. Don't give up. Follow my footprints. I'll get you there. But it says there was darkness. I looked up how long a solar eclipse or a lunar eclipse will last for, and it was just a couple minutes. Just a couple minutes. Yet still the Bible said it was dark for 3 hours. I can't wait to make it to heaven to see the instant replay of what was happening. The epic battle between good and evil taking place right then. Those around the cross, they were missing it. God in his mercy, he had to veil the eyes of humanity for what was taking place. And here it is, our God, our Savior is crying out now. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? You see, our faith is not, you don't just find faith in a crisis. A crisis reveals the quality of faith we have already had. You see, Jesus had been prepared for this from Gethsemane. He's been prepared for this in the wilderness. He is prepared for this for his life. He has learned to follow the will of God because he said, not my will, but your will be done. Are we able to say those words in our moments of despair? You see, what I've come to realize that our greatest blessings come out of our greatest adversities. Our biggest blessings come out of our greatest adversity. And brothers and sisters, these words, which I quite frankly believe are the heaviest words in all of Scripture, because here is Jesus crying out, my God, why have you forsaken me? The same one who cried out, let there be light. The same one who says, pick up your bed and walk. The same one who we celebrate for his power. He spoke to the wind, he spoke to the waves, peace, be still. And they listened. He hung on a cross for you and for me. And I could only imagine the pain, the agony. It was not till I was a teenager before I realized that crucifixion was actually death by suffocation. I thought as a child it was by the spikes driven through your hands or your feet, the blood loss. I was shocked to find out that crucifixion was actually death by suffocation. The thoracic cavity would collapse and the lungs would be prevented from filling up. And in order to breathe, one has to deal with the agony of pulling against those spikes in their hands and their feet to raise up just to get some air. And here it is now. Jesus is pulling up, and as he pulls up, he fills his lungs with air only to cry out, my God, why have you forsaken me? I want you to understand that following the footprints of God is not always going to be easy, but it's going to be essential. I want you to understand today that there is a blessing. You know, they talk about what's at the end of a rainbow. At the end of these footprints is glory. And I want us to know that no matter how difficult it gets, we are to continue to take step after step and don't give up. And for the blessed ones, for those that have been dedicated, listen to me, somebody, as I get ready to wrap up, because there's someone feeling lost right now. They said, but I have followed the footprints. I have followed him. I read my Bible. I pray. I do all of these things, but yet still I've come to this point and there's no footprints. I've looked to the left. I've looked to the right. I'm looking all around me and there's no footprints. God, where are you? Why have you forsaken me? But remember, he came to lay the pathway to eternal life. And there's a activity that we typically do in team building and leadership meetings. They tell the participant to stand, hands out, and their job is to fall backwards to the person behind them who's going to catch them. Have you ever done it? And you know how difficult it could be, because sometimes we start and sometimes we second guess and we keep our feet under us. And what is happening right now? Why so many of us are stuck right now is this. Watch this now. Watch this now. As you fall, something happens to your feet underground. As we fall back, you see, what Jesus was doing here was the climax of the footprints in the sand. He needed to teach us the ultimate lesson of submission, the ultimate lesson of trust. Because as Jesus falls back and as we fall back, our feet come off the ground. No longer is it horizontal, but it's perpendicular. And you see right there, Jesus needs for us to understand as he fell back, he died for us. And as we fall back, we die to self. And he needs for us to die to self and follow him into glory. Brothers, sisters, if you're hearing my voice right now, and you are feeling like you're ready to give up, I just want you to hear the words of God. Because as the devil may want you to think that the footprints ends at the cross, it doesn't. You see, there are footprints leading away from a tomb. Those footprints continue to walk away from the tomb, and he is still saying to us, follow me. Those footprints lead to a place and a mount where he ascends into the sky. Our God has gone, and he has gone to prepare a place for us, and he's coming back. And what we have to do is follow in his footprints. Brothers and sisters, I pray this evening that you will make a decision. I pray that I'll make a decision and that we will make a decision as a family to follow the footprints of God. And in spite of what we may think or feel that God has abandoned us, know that as we fall and as our feet come off the ground, he catches us and he leads us to the tomb to follow him into glory. God bless you.
Wow. Thank you so much, Pastor Baldwin, for reminding us of the necessity of following in God's footprint. That, listen, we're okay to fall faithfully into his hands. Now, as you said that, I was typing in the chat. I was like, I don't know if I've ever done that exercise before. I was a little skeptical about doing that exercise of doing a trust fall, but it's good to know that when it comes to Jesus, that I can spread my arms and I can let my feet off the ground knowing that he will catch me. Into his hands, we can commend ourselves. And so thank you so much for reminding us that he has not left us. But you know, as you mentioned several times throughout your sermon this evening, many people may be feeling as though God has abandoned them. Truth be told, there are moments when I personally have felt like God has abandoned me, even in ministry. Sometimes it makes you feel like, man, God, are you still here? Are you still working with me? Did I do something to make you leave me? What's going on here? But what I'm discovering is that not only do I feel this way, but many people around the world feel this way. And what we've often discovered as time has passed, and if it hasn't for this person, it may for another, and that is that God has not left us. There are moments that we've held God accountable for things, thinking that he did wrong when actually he was never wrong. Maybe he's never left us, and that's what we're discovering even this evening. And so I have a deep challenge for those who are paying attention this evening, as we've given you one every single night, and that is to forgive God. Hear me now. We want you to forgive God for something that you accused him of and have held him hostage to. Stay with me, on abandoning you for. many of us don't grow closer to God because we feel like God doesn't exist or God isn't there. But the truth be told, we have held God hostage to a grudge that we've held in our heart for so long by saying, God, we don't think that you're there. We think that you've left us. And it's time for you to forgive God. But most importantly, it's time for you to ask for forgiveness, because what you may have discovered is that he was there the entire time. He has not left you, y'all. He knows exactly what it's like, for we do not have a high priest who does not sympathize with the things that we feel and has not gone through what we have not gone through. That's the book of Hebrews that testifies that. And even Pastor Baldwin preached it this evening. So I'm challenging you, as you get ready to go on and get ready to close out your evening and eat your final meal per se, or get ready to lay down and rest, I'm encouraging all of you to take a few moments in prayer and say, God, I'm so sorry for thinking that you left me. And here's where I think that you left me. I thought you left me when it was this time, or I thought you left me when it was that time. Listen, bring it to him. These are the moments and the most opportune times that all of us can take advantage of right now. But I'm challenging you to admit to yourself that, hey, there are some times when you thought God left you, but I want you to know he hasn't. He is still with you. And he says, lo, I'm with you always, even until the ends of the age. Even when you can't feel me, I'm still near you. And so I'm going to ask that you would pray that prayer. And as we get ready to close this evening, I want you to pray this prayer with me. Every head is bowed and every eye is closed. God, repeat after me. God, there are moments when I thought that you left me. There are moments when I didn't feel like you were there. God, there are even moments I thought you were unfair. But what I have discovered and am continuing to discover is that you are always there with me. You never left me, but you were there the whole time. You went through it with me. And so, God, I'm trusting you to keep going through with me. For Lord, I will press forward knowing that you are there. Keep me, guide me, heal me, heal our land. Forgive us for thinking you forsook us. And last but not least, God, dear God, save us when you come so that we will never feel like we have to go without you again. Thank you for hearing and answering this prayer, Jesus. And it's in your name we ask all these blessings. Amen. Well, I believe that if you prayed that prayer this evening with me, I believe God is going to show you something marvelous personally. And we look forward to hearing about it. Your testimony does wonders for not only you, but for those around you and us who seek to continue to push this gospel forward. Let us know how God is working in your life. You can do that by posting the hashtag 7LastIAccept on any of your social media platforms. And you can also connect with us via email or our conference website. The email that you can go to is prayer@lrcsda.com. If you want prayer, we can definitely reach out to you and pray for you. You can also put it in the YouTube comments. That's perfectly fine. But we want to connect with you. We want you to connect with us as we all seek to connect greater with this God of ours. Last but not least, feel free to peruse our Lake Region Conference website. Look up a pastor in your area and connect with them. Let them know that you've made a decision that you want to finalize with Jesus Christ and that you want to follow in his footprints. And I promise you, it will be the greatest decision you have ever made of your life. We thank you so much for giving us the greatest investment that you have, and that is your time this evening. And we pray that it has been blessed. We pray that your soul prospers, and we also pray that you'll join us again tomorrow night as we go to the fifth word. You guys, we are only going higher from here, and we praise the Lord for every speaker who has come and ushered us into the presence of God and blessed our souls. But tomorrow, you don't want to miss it. We are going to keep on pushing up the hill toward Golgotha, where one day Jesus would be crucified. That's not how the story ends, but you've got to stick with us to see how it goes. So thank you so much for tuning in. God bless you. We will see you tomorrow.
Come on, rise to your feet. I've got evidence. Say it.
I've got it.
I've got confidence.
I'm
a conqueror.
I'm a conqueror.
I know that I win.
I know, that
I know who I am.
I know who I am.
God wrote it in his plan.
My name
is
my name.
is victory.